Mirror, mirror on the wall, who's the baddest witch of all? Why, the Evil Queen, of course. So bad, evil is canonically in her name. She's cold, jealous, and menacing. The veteran actress providing the Queen's voice also performed the witch, showing an amazing range of acting talent. But who could have brought such variety to the screen? Let's find out. Lucille Laverne was born near Nashville, Tennessee on November 7, 1872. At a young age, she began acting in summer stock theaters, which were theaters that performed stage productions, which, as the name suggests, were only played in the summer. At the age of 14, she was touring with small theater troupes where she often played leading roles, receiving acclaim for her portrayal of another kind-hearted heroine, Lady Macbeth. Her ability to play almost any part quickly caught the attention of more prolific companies. She made her Broadway debut in 1888 in La Tosca. Lucille spent the next several years touring the country with different stock companies, during which she performed in an adaptation of Mark Twain's Pudd'nhead Wilson in 1895. In 1898, she became manager of the Empire Theater in Richmond, Virginia. Her many Broadway credits include William Gillette's Clarice, Uncle Tom's Cabin, 7 Days, and in 1913, she starred in Anne Boyd, a play that she had scripted herself.
Boy, if you're into old films, buckle up, because this lady was in a lot!
Lucille made her film debut in the 1915 comedy Overnight. Over the next decade, she continued performing in both Broadway plays and in film. The 1916 film Sweet Kelly Bellairs with Mae Marsh was Laverne's first prominent role in a major film. In 1917, she was in Polly of the Circus, also with Marsh. In 1920, she returned to the stage for Come Seven, and in 1921, she began performing for D.W. Griffith in Orphans of the Storm. Mm-hmm. 1923 proved to be a busy year for her. I mean, me as well, but whatever. Anyway, not only did she act in D.W. Griffith's The White Rose, but she also performed in Zaza, directed by Alan Dwan. Also in 1923, the 53-year-old played Widow Cagle in Sunup. This Broadway play was a huge success. She would give over 3,000! Good lord. Over 3,000 performances! After performing in D.W. Griffith's America, she reprised her role in the 1925 film version of Sunup. In 1928, she produced, directed, and starred in a Sunup revival on Broadway. With the coming of sound, Lucille began to get smaller roles. Lucille's first sound film, or talkie, if you will, was D.W. Griffith's film, Abraham Lincoln.
Tom Lincoln, it's a-coming.
Boy or gal?
Ain't far enough along yet for a tag.
How's Nancy standing?
She's a-praying.
Other notable sound films include Little Caesar, An American Tragedy, Union Depot, Wheeler and Woolsey's Kentucky Colonels, The Mighty Barnum, and A Tale of Two Cities.
Today, citizeness, your years of waiting end when Master Evremond spits in the sack, eh?
It is not the end. He is not the last of the Evremonds. The wife must follow the husband. The child must follow the father. I'll go to them now. They'll be frantic. They'll denounce the justice of the Republic. And then...
And then!
Take this. Have it ready for me at my usual seat by the guillotine this afternoon.
You can stop wind and fire, but not her.
By these years, she was mostly playing old mothers and old crones, which made her stand out to Walt when he was looking for an old crone for his new movie. Lucy had actually already worked at Disney before, providing the voice for an old crone in the 1932 short, Babes in the Woods.
And everything nice, that's what little children are made of. Sugar and spice.
It was this performance and her reputation as a wonderful stage actress that made Disney consider her for the part of the witch. Bill Cottrell remembered in an interview with historian David Johnson, "Lucille was mostly a stage actress. When the voices were brought in, there were radio shows that had witches in them. Old crones. They all had a pattern that was a cliché, almost as if crones all talked the same way, and so on." Lucille Laverne was brought in late one afternoon. She was almost brusque. This was a no-nonsense character. She took the script from me and read it without looking at the storyboard. You could have made a take from that voice that she read as the queen.
Take her far into the forest. Find some secluded glade where she can pick wildflowers.
Yes, Your Majesty.
And there, my faithful huntsman, you will kill her.
She was a professional actress, and I think when she was told the queen is a vain, imperialistic personality, she visualized something. She read the lines beautifully. Then, when she went into the witch with the maniacal laugh, it rang over the soundstage. It was blood-curdling. We weren't thinking of having one actress do both parts. With the queen's voice, no one read with any great authority, or with anything outstanding. We made a test of her voice and ran it for Walt. He said, "That's it." At first, Cottrell and Grant didn't feel she quite captured the sense of menace as the witch. Overhearing this conversation, Lucille excused herself for a moment and left the room. When she returned, she did the lines again and amazed Cottrell and Grant. Since they had no experience dealing with live performers, they asked what she had done in preparation outside the room in order to get into just the right sound for the character. Lucille smiled.
"I just took out my teeth.
You know, let me try that.
Look at me."
You know, can we cut that? Do you have to put that in here?
Making pies?
Yes, gooseberry pies.
It's apple pies that make the men folks' mouths water. Pies made from apples, like these.
As a result, it gave that wet sort of sound. Her jaws collapsed and she was the witch. She was a pro. We did not have to do too many takes with her, only to try a different interpretation.
My heart. Oh, my poor heart. Take me into the house and let me rest. A drink of water, please.
Some at the studio thought Lucille sounded too old for the queen, but as director David Hand said, the main point of argument is really that Laverne knows how to deliver lines. We are willing to sacrifice a little to get that correct delivery, that punch we need.
The heart of a pig, the blundering fool. I'll go myself to the dwarf's cottage in a disguise so complete no one will ever suspect.
When one of the writers of the scene suggested a change to the witch's dialogue, Walt responded, "All the dialogue sounded bad to me until she read it." Lucille voicing both roles helped unify the two characters despite the differences in their voices and performances. The crippled evil inside the queen manifested itself physically when she transformed into the witch. After performing in her last Broadway play, Black Widow, in 1936, and performing the witch in two radio productions in 1937 and 1938, Lucille retired to spend more time with her granddaughter. Back in 1933, Lucille was diagnosed with cancer and underwent two surgeries before it went into remission. Tragically, in 1945, her cancer returned, and she passed away at the age of 75. Lucille's career as an actress is incredibly impressive. From stage, to silent film, to talkies, to Disney animation, she brought a level of professionalism and sincerity to her roles, especially her role as the Evil Queen. The simple contrast between the cold and composed queen and the manic and malicious witch says wonders about her talent. And in the end, I think we all know who the fairest one of all really was.
Breath. We're still. Blood congealed.
Oh.
Thank you for watching this episode of Dizographies. Click the thumbs up button below if you liked it, and if you want to be notified when the next episode comes out, consider subscribing. Comment below with characters you would like to see us cover. Further reading and references are linked in the description. We hope to see you in another Dizography.